thank you again, Robert. I wanted to flash back to the very beginnings of the modernist temperament before we move ahead with its survival in the period between the world wars. If I had to pick a date, when did something like modernism begin? The date I would pick would be in the year 1762. In that year, there was published a remarkable book by Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Now, you may recall Rousseau as one of the leading French intellectual, actually Swiss, he was a Swiss Protestant by background, intellectual whose works were influential in leading up to the French Revolution. Well, in 1762, Rousseau published a book called A Meal, or On Education, which is a book which has had a sad influence, I'm sorry to say, on some of our modern catechists, but I want to leave all of that aside. The section of the book that is ancestral to modernism is a little section called the Creed of the Savoyard Vicar. Savoyard is the adjective formed from the place name Savoy, which was down in the south between France and Italy. Savoy, Creed of the Vicar of Savoy. And that's been translated into English many times. You can find oftentimes that little part of A Meal published separately under some title like the Creed of the Savoyard Vicar. It's a section in which, fictionally, Rousseau introduces a Roman Catholic parish priest who has some highly unusual ideas. These are ideas of which Rousseau himself approves. Now, this is a remarkable passage in a book by a Protestant and by a person who is quite a radical in his social and political thinking, whose ideas will lead to the French Revolution. Because in this section of his book, he is highly congratulatory towards the Roman Catholic clergy. He thinks they are a wonderful and admirable group of men. But of course, Rousseau could not share the dogmas of their faith. So he admires the priests, but he cannot accept their dogmas. And so he fictionalizes a priest who succeeds in having, from his point of view, the best of both worlds, the priestly ministry and no dogmas. The religion of the Savoyard vicar is a religion stripped to the bare essentials. What does this man believe in? Well, he believes in a wise God, the soul, morals, duty. A wise God, the soul, morals, duty. Those are the very ingredients which will appear about not quite 40 years later in Kant's celebrated critique of practical judgment. The same things that Rousseau thought were essential in the Creed of the Savoyard Vicar are the elements which Kant thought were essential to the moral life. Belief in a wise God, the soul, morals, and duty. In other words, the Savoyard Vicar is a deist in his beliefs. Now, deism is a term that you may know from American history. Thomas Paine was a celebrated deist. Thomas Jefferson was a celebrated deist. You often hear deism summarized as the belief that God is sort of a wise watchmaker. He invents the universe as an intricate work of art, winds it up, and from there on it runs on its own. Deism believes in God as creator of the natural order and as author of a morality that's grounded somehow in human nature. But deism does not believe in any supernatural interventions. Deists therefore rejected any ecclesiastical institution, rejected sacraments, rejected the scriptures, rejects anything supernatural. So, for the most part of the late 17th and early 18th centuries, when deism had existed, deism was nasty and militant, especially against the Catholic Church. Deism distrusted all organized Christian denominations. But of all the denominations, which one was the most steeped in priestcraft? Where was mummery the thickest? But in the superstitious and debased Church of Rome. Is it not so? No, that's how Tom Paine talked, see? Here is the great turn in Rousseau. Deism turned sentimental and pro-Catholic. The deist priest, the Savoyard vicar, remains at his post. Rousseau asks him in their imaginary conversation, "Since, my dear fellow, you don't believe much more than I do, why do you stay here dispensing the Eucharist and baptisms and confession and so on?" And the deist priest answers this. He remains at his post, dispensing the ceremonies with mystic, sentimental devoutness so as to benefit the people. Now, here is a new and very important idea. It is a new idea for deists, perhaps not so new to us. But the idea is that moral education requires a symbolic mediation. It's no good standing up in front of a congregation of people to lecture on the natural law out of, I don't know what, the book of nature or something. That won't draw a crowd. That won't keep them coming back Sunday after Sunday. In order to instruct, educate, benefit people in better understanding their duties and their dignity as moral agents and their importance as human beings and so on, there has to be a rich, dense religious symbolism that can fascinate and attract people. And then it's within the context of that symbolism that the moral doctrine can be given. See? That's Rousseau's idea. Now, what's really new here is a new ecclesiology. Notice how Rousseau is in effect saying that the church exists not to teach a revealed truth, but to nourish the religious and moral impulses of the people through an appropriate symbolism. The church exists not to teach a revealed truth, but to nourish the religious and moral impulses of the people through an appropriate symbolism. Now, if there was ever an idea that was going to have a future, there it was. By thinking like the Savoyard vicar, 130 years later, hundreds and perhaps thousands of Catholic priests could remain in their parishes, remain in their posts on this basis, dispensing the ceremonies, not to teach a revealed truth, but in their view, and pious hope at least, to nourish the religious and moral impulses of the people. Notice how, in a smooth-sounding way, with lots of sugar to help the pill go down, what's being said here is that the real aim and function of the Catholic Church is secular human betterment. See? People need help with their moral lives. People want to do good, but you know how it is. We've got a lot of struggles, a lot of problems. The selfishness of this world is everywhere. People need some guidance, some bucking up. There it is. That's what the church is for. Human improvement. And I would say, if I may anticipate something that I think Father Skerris will get into this evening, there are even the roots here in this work of 1762 of a new view of the liturgy. You know, by 1762 already, a lot of people realized that the Protestant Reformation had gone too far in purging Christian worship of its aesthetic elements. And a lot of people were in a position to realize, even by 1762, that the Protestant clergy, who were just like all your other married neighbors with their wives and kids, were not especially exciting or admirable people. But the Catholic priest, with his heroic vow of celibacy, his self-dedication, and the known example of so many heroic people of sanctity, made the Catholic priest an attractive figure and made Catholic liturgy an attractive form of symbolism. But notice, if it's only symbolism, if the liturgical rites are only symbolism whose measure is how well they support the program of moral instruction. For purposes today, you might add a good dose of political instruction. If that's the only measure of it, then as times and cultures change, the liturgical symbols must change. See? A utilitarian view of the liturgy, from which we are suffering again in our own day. Now, what interests me is that Rousseau's Creed of the Savoyard Vicar enjoyed an instant success. It was received with great praise the day it was published and has been avidly read ever since, which indicates to me that Rousseau was speaking for and helping to gel a new consensus, a new view of what religion could be and should be. And that new view, what I call sentimental deism, or deism with a rich symbolic crust, That new view was to become the main and dominant view of the 19th century. If you if you look at the great intellectual figures of the 19th century, both in the sciences and in philosophy and even in literature, if you look at everybody from Matthew Arnold to Hegel to Humboldt to Diltai to Coleridge to Mendebiron, from one end of that century to the other, Schleiermacher, Schlegel, John Stuart Mill, Macaulay, Mach, William James. There's a whole constellation of figures you can look at in that period, and you will find that they are all pro-religion. How different from the best-known intellectual figures of the 18th century, people of the older consensus before Rousseau. Think how hostile to religion Voltaire was. And contrast that to the main figures of the 19th century. They're all pro-religion. In fact, there's only one important exception in the 19th century. Only one well-known 19th century figure who's actually anti-religious. Well, that's Marx. But apart from him, you had materialistic scientists, you had positivistic philosophers, you had idealist philosophers, you had ideologues and crackpots of every description, all pro-religious. Religion is wonderful, indispensable, good, sweet, beneficial to mankind, and much to be promoted, and God forbid that anything I've said in my published works should be thought to touch religion. I love it. But along with this pro-religious attitude went the contempt of theology. There it is in the Creed of the Savoyard Vicar, and this new consensus would last for well over, 200 years. Religion, yay, good. Theology, boo, bad. And we see yet another version of that peculiar position emerging in our own day in this New Age movement, in which you've got people running around muttering into crystals and so on, all in the name of religion, but in contempt of all definite formulation of any definite truth about the divine being, as though the divine being were palpable but ineffable, right? All right, well, that is the origin then of this mindset, which characterized the 19th century after Rousseau's time, emerged even stronger after the French Revolution, emerged strongly in the romantic reaction against the French Revolution. Religion was again good and praised. Even conservative and orthodox religion was good and praised as long as you left the theology out. And then has come down to haunt us in our own day. All right. Well, I talked last time about a definition and gave some examples, I hope, of wherein the specificity of modernism as a movement in the Roman Catholic Church consisted. Now, as you all know, these modernist tendencies were condemned in two major documents, the Decree Lamentabili of July the 3rd, 1907. Well, it was signed on July the 3rd and promulgated on July the 4th. So one year we had a party about that. on the 4th of July, there were 65 propositions and we had 65 fireworks. Okay? You can send up a rocket for each of the condemnations. I recommend that sort of party very highly. And the other, encyclical Pascendi of the year or two following. Now, we can get into the details of what was condemned in those two documents, if you like. And perhaps some of that can come up in the question period, for which I'll try to save plenty of time. But I want to hasten on to the topic now, in which I know you're all quite interested, and that is the transmission. How did modernism survive these condemnations? And through what underground channels did its program survive, hang on, so as to come back to life in such a vivid way after the Second World War, and especially after the Second Vatican Council? Well, again, I lament the absence of a blackboard, but I want to say something to you at least about three channels of transmission. One of them very direct, the other two more circumspect and more indirect. The three channels of transmission are, number one, through Teilhard de Chardin. Okay? He's the direct channel. He's the unreformed McCoy. Okay? The second channel, less dire and less direct, is through the work of Maurice Blondel. B-L-O-N-D-E-L. Okay. And the third channel the third channel is through transcendental Thomism, as it is called, which is an elaborate intellectual enterprise whereby, under the accidents of Thomistic terminology, a mysterious transubstantiation occurs in which the substance of Thomistic metaphysics is replaced by the substance of German idealist metaphysics. Okay? With dire consequences. Now, the second and the third channel are very difficult to explain because the people who were working on these channels were very competent in what they were doing, very intelligent men. They knew the difficulty of their task, which would be to formulate what they wanted to say in a way which would not obviously challenge the norms of orthodoxy. And so you're dealing with men who are extremely careful in what they have to say, and sometimes one has to simply leave to God the judgment as to the disposition of their hearts. Were they trying to be modernists, or were they trying really to serve the church, but in an unfortunate way? That I cannot always say. But let's talk first about that first channel of transmission, because that, in my opinion, is an open and shut case. Père Teilhard de Chardin was a French Jesuit who showed no aptitude whatever for philosophy or theology. And so the Jesuits put him to work studying something they thought he could understand, namely rocks. He was interested in geology and in fossils. And somehow or other, he had acquired in his early youth a firm attachment to an evolutionary worldview. And the Jesuit scholasticate in those days had to be moved out of France. You could not study to be a Jesuit in France in the decades when Père Teilhard was receiving his formation, because the anti-clerical governments of the Third Republic had closed all such religious orders and their teaching institutions. So the French Jesuits had moved their scholasticate across the English Channel. And that is how Teilhard de Chardin became familiar with the situation in England. And I'm not able to put a date on this, but shortly after the First World War, when he served as a chaplain in the French army, he was able to become acquainted with Maud Petrie. Now, I mentioned Maud Petrie in here before. I gave you a definition of modernism that she had put forward. Maud Petrie is an interesting witness to all of this, because she was the secretary, housekeeper, and towards the end, nurse to the most prominent of the English language modernists. This was Father George Tyrrell, T-Y-R-R-E-L-L. Father Tyrrell was another Jesuit, although he was forced to leave the Jesuit order before he was finally excommunicated. But he wrote the most accessible works of modernist output that you can probably find, since he did write in English, and I'm sorry to say wrote awfully well, so that you will find yourself turning the pages and often with admiration. His best known works are Through Scylla, Through Nova et Vetera, New Things and Old, Through Scylla and Charybdis, Lex Orandi, a companion volume, Lex Credendi, and those were all published under his own name. Then he also had a great many pseudonymous productions. That is to say, things that he didn't sign or put somebody else's name on, put a fictitious name on. Now, Tyrrell was condemned by name and died shortly thereafter. He died, I believe, if I'm not getting my dates wrong, he died in 1910. He became quite ill in middle age. And Miss Petrie then put together his correspondence for him and published it shortly after his demise, and then wrote repeatedly on the subject of what the modernists had been up to and what their hopes had been and so on. She was a little center of pilgrimage. She was the surviving participant in the modernist movement who wasn't the least bit ashamed of it and wasn't trying to run away. Now, there was a much more prominent participant in Great Britain than she, but he was running from it as fast as his legs could carry him, and that was Baron Freddy von Hugel, who, despite his German name, had a Scottish mother, lived in England, and married into the upper British aristocracy, which gave him plenty of money and freedom to travel. He was the Maecenas, that is to say, the aristocratic patron of the modernist movement. When you wonder where the money for modernist congresses came from, and who it was who could travel around and put all these people into contact with one another, it was Baron von Hugel. But after the thing was condemned, and especially after the First World War, Baron von Hugel wished to forget that he'd had anything to do with it, so he wasn't any help anymore. and besides which he died in 1925, but Maud Petrie was thrilled with the whole movement, and Father Tyrrell had been her sun, her moon, and her hero, and she didn't care who knew it, and her house was open to anybody sympathetic, and she was one of Père Teilhard de Chardin's best friends in the world, certainly his best friend in England. They knew each other, they corresponded. I said a moment ago that Père Teilhard had an evolutionary worldview. Now, this is the right way to put it, and it shows you already there's just something very odd about this. Among serious-minded people, there is a legitimate discussion of evolution as a biological hypothesis. That's not a worldview. The discussion is whether genetic material admits, over the course of geological time, of a process of mutation which is sufficient to allow new species to appear. If it does, then new species can arise by mutation and natural selection without requiring some sort of new act of creation on God's part. Although those who would argue that these mutations do occur and are sufficient to account for new species would, of course, argue for a theistic component to that process. But God would be there by way of a primary cause and not by way of a categorical cause. Well, I mean, that's another story. But for Teilhard de Chardin, evolution was not primarily a possibility in biology. Evolution was a matter of worldview. Teilhard believed that human history was evolution continued. Now this, no responsible biologist, no responsible evolutionist believes. There is a British biologist, very famous, named Sir Peter Medawar, who wrote such devastating reviews of Teilhard's books when they were finally published in English in the late 1950s, that as a result, Teilhardianism never caught on in Great Britain. But alas, Sir Peter's reviews were not read in the United States, and so there was quite a cult of that character on our side of the Atlantic. Teilhard accepted a worldview in which evolution begins before there are any genes and continues even as we speak. Teilhard ran together the central Christian doctrines of creation, incarnation, and redemption to make them three aspects of one and the same mysterious cosmic process, according to him. He denies creation ex nihilo. He believed that matter has in some sense always existed, but in chaotic form. God's introduction of order into the primitive chaos is at the same time creation and the beginnings of the incarnation of the Logos. So creation and incarnation are run together. Teilhard had a religious sentiment in which he wanted with all of his heart to worship the universe. He really did. He tells us so in his journals. He just found it the most fascinating religious object he could conceive, and he could not bear the idea of God as really distinct from the universe. He wanted God to be in it so firmly, so totally, that in the end, he ran the dogmas of creation and incarnation together. Now, it was a long time before anything of his in which he said that was published. He wrote a sugared-over version of his position called The Divine Milieu and the companion piece called The Phenomenon of Man. Now, they're both bad enough, but they're not as bad as the real Teilhard. Those sugared-over versions, he tried to get published and was repeatedly blocked, rejected by the authorities of his religious order, the Society of Jesus. Posthumously, they were finally published. But the works of his in which he revealed his mind most fully, he never even tried to publish. These are works such as The Human Sense, which he wrote in 1925, while he was on a tour down in Abyssinia. Per Teilhard wrote that traditional Christianity is simply finished. The God of the creeds is a Neolithic landlord, and he must be expelled from our minds, and dogma must be revised to get rid of this idea of a God who is above us, like an owner of the universe. What we really need, what modern man and modern consciousness demand, is a God who is not above us, but ahead of us. A God who is in the future. A divinity towards whom we are evolving as to an end point, the omega point. He conceived of the whole career of the universe as a gradual emergence from chaos through complexification of structure, more and more complicated minerals, and by beyond that to the complexification of cells, and at a certain point of complexification, things fold over on themselves often enough that somehow sensation emerges. And when you have enough neural layers folded over on themselves, somehow consciousness emerges. The grain of consciousness in the individual human being is simply the result of having put enough together of the original particles of matter, all of which have some pre-grain of consciousness. And our own little consciousnesses are destined to evolve, collect, fold over upon each other through the formation of a noosphere until finally there's one center of consciousness, which is planet-wide. That's the noosphere. And then this is no doubt happening on other planets, and somehow in the end they're all going to connect up and we're going to have this divinized, conscientified universe. That's his object of worship. Needless to say, he was somewhat embarrassed what to make of the historical Jesus. He doesn't seem to have awaited to the end. He seems to have come in the middle. What to make of such a thing? Well, I won't bore you with any more of this. I only want to let you know that Teilhard's modernism came to him from the originals of the movement. He had a brief correspondence with Lavoisier. He had a longer correspondence with Maurice Blondel, whom I'll be talking about in a minute. And he was an avid reader of René Martin Dugarde. In the first session we had this morning, I read you that loathsome paraphrase of the Creed by a French modernist named Marcel Hébert, who at the turn of the century was the headmaster at a very fashionable French prep school, okay, called the École Fénelon. So that boys of a very good family who were going on to university often went through his hands. And one of those upon whom Marcel Hébert had a great influence was a young man named Roger Martin Dugard, who went on in subsequent life to become a very well-off popular novelist. His best-known work is a novel called Jean Barrois, B-A-R-O-I-S, which by 1970 had been through 150 editions. Okay. He's not well known in the English-speaking world, thank goodness, but if you go to your local library and look up in the card catalog, you might find something, some novel of Martin Dugard, G-A-R-D, D-U-G-A-R-D, translated. His most famous novel is Jean Barrois, in which there is a bad marriage, a very sad marriage, between a very pious French woman and her unbelieving socialist husband. Now these two have been at each other for years. The husband is Jean Barrois, all right. He's a nasty, typical, anti-clerical Frenchman, hates priests and popes and mummeries and ceremonies and all that stuff, and he's dedicated to socialism and justice. Well, his wife never drops the rosary beads, and so these two have been at each other for years. She's been nagging him to repent of his sins and get baptized. So anyway, this has been going. Now they get a new priest comes to the village. All right. And it's a modernist priest, okay, modeled on Marcel Hébert himself, who was the author's teacher. And, of course, you know, the new priest comes to town, and the pious and extremely anxious wife, who's concerned about her husband's immortal soul, goes to the priest and tells him the whole sad story. I've been working with my husband for years, you know, to get him to, oh, my gosh, he's such a hard man, Father. Maybe you could come and speak to him. And he says, oh, well, now, perhaps you should leave him alone, you know, try, you know, the more flies with honey, you know. And, well, she tries that for a while with no better success, and finally there comes a crisis. Her husband has a stroke or a heart attack or something, and he's laid up and he's in danger of dying, and she comes to the priest and, oh, Father, what am I to do? He's in danger of death. Won't you come and finally speak to him? So he finally pays a visit, comes and speaks to them, and of course spends most of the time lecturing the wife for being a narrow-minded bigot, and consoling Jean Barrois for being what we would call today, this is not in the book, but we would call it today, an anonymous Christian. See? You really love the good, don't you? You love justice so much, Jean, do you not? I represent one who loves justice too, you know. Well, in the end, the modernist priest gives husband and wife an ironical piece of advice, which becomes the most famous line of the book. My dear woman, says the priest, your thoughts are ever rising and ascending to the throne of the Eternal Father. And my dear Monsieur Barrois, long-suffering husband, your thoughts too are ever rising and ascending towards the beautiful future of human justice to which we all aspire. And I would say that you are not so far apart, you and she, as you imagine, for everything that rises must converge. Everything that rises must converge. It's in this novel. It is also one of the most memorable lines of Teilhard de Chardin. It appears in The Phenomenon of Man, if I'm not mistaken, without so much as a thank you to where he really got it from. And it is such a preposterous line that wonderful woman, Flannery O'Connor, couldn't resist taking it up and put it on the front page of one of her most brutal short stories. All right, so there's a direct line of transmission. Now, Teilhard was brought back from China in the late 1940s because there was a change of command in the Jesuit order. The Jesuits were switched on to a different attitude towards the kind of thing that Teilhard stood for. The new authorities of the order brought him back, allowed him to tour and lecture throughout Europe. And they connived at the arrangement whereby his works were given to an independent publishing consortium prior to his death, so that when he finally died in 1952, his works could begin to be published independently of ecclesiastical censorship. There was a huge Teilhard cult then ginned up in many countries of the world, especially France and the United States, and has had a deleterious influence ever since. Now let me talk a little bit about that second line or channel of communication. Whose starting point is a man named Maurice Blondel. Maurice Blondel got his doctorate in philosophy at the Sorbonne in 1892, and then went on and lived a very long and very quiet life. Left Paris shortly thereafter and ended up teaching down in the south of France at Aix-la-Chapelle, and was down there until, I think, in 1950 or 51 when he finally died. But at the height of the modernist movement, he was a co-editor of one of the most important philosophy journals in France, where he wrote viciously against the pastoral policies of the Holy See and strongly in defense of the major modernist writers. He wrote under the pseudonym Testis, T-E-S-T-I-S, witness. Blondel himself never articulated a terribly radical theological position, although he was quite radical in some of his philosophical positions. But in the crunch of the modernist battle, the scholars against the Holy See, he was definitely on the side of the scholars and a strong critic of Pius X. He himself escaped condemnation for two reasons. A, he was a layman. We are generally beneath beneath the notice, I'm happy to say, of if you're a priest and say terrible things, there's a possibility that you could be excommunicated by name, but it's very rare for that to happen to a layman. Although I suppose it did happen to Leander Perez, but that wasn't particularly that was another matter. And then he had a teacher of his who had some friends in the Vatican who went to bat for him, and so he had his chestnuts pulled out of the fire. Now his principal interests had been in, at the turn of the century, his principal interests were in apologetics. How do we vindicate and show the truth of the Christian faith? And what was peculiar about Blondel was this: he had no patience whatsoever with traditional apologetics. Traditional apologetics seeks to show that there are good reasons to believe that the scriptures are what they purport to be, namely the revealed word of God, that Jesus said and did what the gospels say he said and did, that these are credible witnesses, and so on. So traditional apologetics gets into many issues of biblical criticism, historical research, trying to show that what we say God said, he really did say. Blondel had no patience with this kind of apologetics and fostered another approach in which his argument was that Christian dogmas could all be defended as meeting to a T the inner needs of the human person. Meeting to a T the inner needs of the human person. The reason you should believe these dogmas is because we need them to be true. We need there to be a supernatural complement to man's natural energies. We need there to be a redemption by blood. We need there to be an incarnation. We need there to be a Trinity. Now, exactly how you were supposed to tease out of man's psychology and experience an argument that we couldn't be happy unless there were exactly three persons in the Trinity, this was left a little bit obscure by Blondel. It's hard to see how that argument would work, but he insisted it would. And this was his plan of apologetics. Now, the problem with this, of course, is that he had to say that man has a naturally knowable need for the supernatural. Man has a naturally knowable need for the supernatural. We can show by mere philosophy, he argued, if we do it right, if we argue right, we can show by sheer philosophy that we need the supernatural. Now, he admitted philosophy could not prove that the supernatural was given to us, that it was real. You couldn't prove by reason or philosophy alone that grace is really there, but you could prove we need it. One of the reasons why Blondel and Teilhard de Chardin had such a long and fruitful correspondence with each other is because they both needed there to be something less than a strong distinction between the natural and the supernatural. Teilhard needed to collapse the supernatural into the natural. Blondel was not that bad. But he needed the natural to have an intrinsic ordination to the supernatural so that the two would at least be inseparable, even if they weren't identical. Now, Blondel was very strongly attacked by Thomist philosophers at the turn of the century, precisely on the ground that he was destroying the gift character of grace. He was turning grace into wages. He was making the supernatural something so necessary to us that God would owe it to us. Then grace is no longer a gift. It's no longer contingent to us. It's no longer gratuitous. It's something like a demand of our nature. And once you have pulled down grace, the vision of God, and so on, out of its own order and made it a demand of our nature, then of course you can go very far towards reinterpreting the whole of Christianity as a natural fruit of man's evolving religious sense. Christianity no longer has to be revealed from heaven if it can also be excogitated from the earth as a clarification of what we naturally need to be true. Ideal religious wish fulfillment. Now, Blondel, of course, would have reacted very strongly against that description of his views. But his views were certainly regarded as very dangerous, strongly criticized at the turn of the century, strongly criticized in a book written in 1912 called immanence. He was the founder of the method of and the philosophy of immanence. Now that's the starting point of this line of transmission. Who else is in this line? Well, who were Blondel's disciples and admirers? Under a cloud for many years because of his known associations with the modernists. Under a cloud for many years because of his anti-Thomistic outbursts. Nevertheless, he had disciples and admirers. Who were they? Some of them you've probably never heard of. Maurice Nadoncel, does that ring a bell? Fellow named Alchambeau, ring a bell? Fellow named Henri de Lubac, ring a bell? Oh yes. Henri de Lubac is the most celebrated and certainly the most accomplished admirer of Maurice Blondel. Now, I don't know what all to make of Henri de Lubac. The man is an enigma to me. Certainly, there is nothing like overt modernism in any of his works. Nevertheless, he had a very bad collection of friends, some of whom are certainly to be counted as neo-modernists. And he wrote works strongly praising and trying to make coherent Teilhard de Chardin. Now you hear all kinds of things about that. He wasn't really all that sure of Teilhard. His Jesuit superiors ordered him to write in Teilhard's defense. True? I don't know. But in any case, Henri de Lubac's own work, most controversial and famous work, centered on nature and grace, and tried to argue that Blondel's position, that man is naturally ordered to the supernatural, so that it is inconceivable, really, and never to be affirmed, that God could even have created man without calling him to the supernatural order of gifts. That thesis he defended strongly and argued that it was to be found in St. Augustine and even in St. Thomas, and made a strong attack on the neo-scholastic theologians who read these great fathers and doctors of the church otherwise. And certainly, whatever Père de Lubac's personal intentions may have been, there has come out of his work an extremely disagreeable influence, some of which he himself has had to lament, of people who read him as really denying any distinction between the natural and the supernatural orders. You see, this is really an extremely extremely dangerous business. Monkeying around, softening in any way the distinction between the natural and the supernatural is immensely dangerous. Right? This is not to say that the distinction must not be understood. Of course, the distinction must be understood in its exactitude and in its true subtlety. Nevertheless, it must be maintained. And anything that would tend to collapse that distinction is immensely dangerous. You may recall when we were all oppressed in the middle of the 1960s by priests and nuns who had just finished reading The Divine Milieu and the Phenomenon of Man. And they, right after the council, they were full of these works and had a new conception of the religious life, and we were no longer going to be recruiting people out of the world and calling people to self-renunciation and asceticism and abandonment and so on and so on, but rather we had a new concept of our mission, We were going to build the earth. Do you remember that stuff? Some of you are old enough to remember that. We were going to build the earth. Well, it doesn't take you very long to figure out that if your game is to build the earth, the habit is in the way. And so out it goes. And if the purpose of the church is turned towards secular schemes of improvement, then the church has to be streamlined and reorganized to make her a better political microphone. But as soon as you take away the distinction between the natural and the supernatural, all of those moves become legitimate. Who's to say that building better mousetraps, building parking lots, cobbling together the noosphere, and so on, who's to say that that isn't supernatural? Who's to say where the natural ends and the supernatural begins? If you want an example of a theology in which the distinction between the natural and the supernatural has really been thrown away, so that the two are run shamelessly into one another, all you have to do is look at the theology of liberation. For whom it would seem that not only political power, but even salvation comes out of the barrel of a gun. All right. Third line of transmission, and I'm really over time now, so I can only just mention this. There were a number of people connected with the modernist movement whose central interest was not in scripture studies or anything, but whose main interest was in modern philosophy. They really believed that in one or another version of German idealist philosophy, there were also French versions of idealism, but in one of these versions of idealist philosophy, there was the ideal philosophy for the church to pick up and use in our time, just as the church had used the philosophy of Plato in the patristic age, and just as the church, after some initial misgivings, had taken up and used to wonderful effect the philosophy of Aristotle in the Middle Ages, so now there was a new philosophy, a better and evolved thing, better than those old ones, and really fruitful, and the church could just take that up and instantly establish some common ground with the modern age, which would then greatly assist in the preaching of the gospel. Now, I haven't got time to go into a long explanation of what German idealism is, or French idealism for that matter. They're not all that different. All versions of idealism are really peas in a pod. So let me give this to you real quick. Idealist metaphysics is a reaction to Kant, who had pronounced a great divorce, if I can put it that way, between knowledge and reality, between what we can experience and how things really are. Kant had claimed that man cannot get at the truth of things in themselves. We are imprisoned in a house of experiences which is largely of our own making. Okay. Now, not many people could stand that. And idealist philosophers in particular couldn't stand that divorce. They didn't know how to get rid of it, but they weren't happy with it either. Their basic move was to reason as follows. Kant has shown that all knowledge of objects outside ourselves, knowledge that comes to us through the senses, is shaped and colored by our own cognitional apparatus, so we're not getting at the real. But Kant has forgotten that there is a reality that we're already inside of. We don't have to judge by its appearances, phenomena. There's a reality we're already inside of. It's ourselves. We are already present inside a real chunk of being. It's ourselves. And so idealist philosophers want to look within ourselves, introspectively, and find within our own conscious experience of ourselves a clue to what all of reality is like, so as to start metaphysics over again on that basis. An introspective clue to the nature of all reality. Now, it's difficult for me to imagine a more comical or preposterous project. Nevertheless, they believed strongly in it. Idealist philosophers differed from one another in which clue they found. But whichever clue they picked up, they handled it the same way. Let's take Ravaisson, for example, a French idealist. He looks into man, and the clue that he finds deep down within himself is freedom. And so he concludes, it builds up an elaborate metaphysical system to argue that every being deep down in the depths of its reality is free. What about rocks, Monsieur Ravaisson? The rocks, the rills, the stocks, the sticks, they're free? Ah, yes, he says. They are all free, but they have some very fixed habits. But deep down, everything is a little gob of freedom. Oh, how about Schopenhauer? Let's go across the Rhine and pick up Schopenhauer, another example of an idealist philosopher. Wrote a book called The World as Will and Representation. The representations are the phenomena. The will is the inner reality of everything. Schopenhauer looked into himself and seized on the clue called the will. I have a will. So he projects that then onto all of reality and says that everything deep down is a little gob of will. What are the stones already? The rocks, the rills, the sticks, the stocks, they have a will? Why do you think that when you step on a stone, your foot doesn't go through it? It's resisting you, that is will. I kid you not. Huh? It's in there. Everything is deep down a little gob of will. And unfortunately, Schopenhauer had also spent some time reading the Sanskrit classics, and was deeply into Buddhism and believed that deeply fascinated with Buddhism and believed that this is the reason man is so unhappy. Because deep down we're a gob of will, and we're never going to be happy until we renounce will. Hegel is perhaps the most famous of the German idealist philosophers. He also looks in man's conscious experience for a clue to what all reality is like, and he picked on something else, that's all. He picked on the dialectical structure of reasoning or conversation. The dialectical flow of things in a reasoning, a discussion, or an argument. How the mind goes from one topic to another. He picked on that, the flow of reason. And made that his clue to what all of reality is like. The whole universe becomes a dialectical unfolding. Yeah. The project of transcendental Thomism was to take Thomistic metaphysics and, without anybody's being able to notice quite how it's done, turn it into a form of German idealism. This takes considerable skill, very considerable skill. However, Karl Rahner managed to do it. He doesn't tell you that this is what he's doing, but once you know, you can see it right off. in the very beginning of his book, Hearers of the Word, Hörer des Wortes, he says he needs to clue the reader in on what he's going to mean by being. Well, it's a key term in philosophy and metaphysics, so thank you for the clue. We'd like to hear. What are you going to mean by being? And he says that I'm going to use being to mean presence to self, a Bei-sich-sein. Being is presence to self. Being is therefore an inner illumination in which each thing is present to itself, in a kind of conscious or pre-conscious possession, in at least a pre-thematic self-possession. What he's doing is looking into man in the standard idealist strategy, finding his clue to what all reality is like. His clue is self-consciousness. Self-consciousness is some kind of presence to self. What Rahner is saying is that all being is like that. All being is self-consciousness. Well, Father Rahner, the rocks, the rills, the sticks, the stocks? Yes, he says. In volume 4 of his Schriften zur Theologie, in an essay on Christology within the perspective of an evolutionary universe, he actually says, I'm sorry I don't have the page number with me, but this is in so many words, matter is frozen spirit. Frozen spirit, like frozen yogurt. Frozen spirit. He really means it. To be is to be self-conscious. Even the rocks, insofar as they are little gobs of self-consciousness, but they're not too reflective. They're a little fixed in their habits, so to speak. Well, this allows him to go on and then pull very many very fancy moves. Isn't God the supreme fullness of being, according to St. Thomas? Yes. Isn't God ipsum esse subsistens, subsistent being itself? Yes. Doesn't St. Thomas say that in God esse and intelligere are the same, being and knowing are one? Yes. Case dismissed. Okay. In God, being and knowing are identical, therefore they're identical in the creature. Strange move. That's not Thomism, but that's Rahner. Well, with being and knowing made identical, the universe can be arranged in a vast ascending series of beings who more or less know that they are self-conscious. From those who don't know it much, like the protons and the neutrons, up to us who do, and beyond us to God. And everything can be strung out in a dialectical order of progression. I haven't got time to go into the details of his theological system. It's a disaster from many perspectives. Rahner had a teacher named Joseph Maréchal, from whom he got the project of transcendental Thomism. Rahner rarely attributes his ideas to Maréchal. He's more often likely to say that he got his ideas from Heidegger, but it isn't so. He got his ideas from Joseph de Maréchal. Maréchal, in turn, was a great admirer of Pierre Rousselot, a French Jesuit. Very bright young fellow who was shot down in World War II. And Pierre Rousselot was a disciple of Maurice Blondel, whom Rahner never mentions. But Rahner also has his way of running together nature and grace. Well, these are just some sketches, these are just some ideas. To give you an idea of what some of the movements have been through which original modernist ideas have come down. I'm going to close this talk by giving you just one more thing to think about. If you want to look for a clue as to whether a writer is a modernist or not. Okay. You want to see what he will say on the subject of divine revelation, as I was talking about this morning. You want to see what he would say on that subject. And in particular, you want to see whether he leaves room for what I call the modernist gap. The modernist gap is between, it's an empty space, between divine revelation and the dogmas of the church as actually formulated and taught. Now, if there's no space between those things, if the dogmas of the church as she has actually taught them and formulated them connect up exactly and express divine revelation exactly without a gap, then there's no room for modernism. Then the faith has been captured and certain controversies are closed and large-scale reformulations of the faith are out of the question. But if there's a gap in there, aha, there's room to maneuver. So that's the key thing to look for. Does a theologian say, oh, God speaks to us, yes, but the divine speech, she is beyond, she is transcendent. The divine speech, she is unutterable. Our speech, our dogmas, are merely the halting human efforts to express the divine word. Is that what he says? He's a modernist. Now there's a gap. Because if our words, if our dogmas are only the halting, ever-failing attempts to express what no human words can convey but which God has said, then yesteryear's formulations can be thrown out as times and demands change. It can be pretended that theology must continually move with every new fad in sociology, like feminism, or with every new fad in metaphysics, like Hegelianism, or phenomenology, or with every new fad in politics. And then the dogmas of yesterday can be subjected to a purely pragmatic critique. Do we like to hear that anymore? If the dogmas of yesterday sound somehow disappointing to us, or would crimp our style or stand in the way of what we want to do as we move with the times, that can become a signal that, hey, these things need to be revised. This is no longer living communication. We've got to fix this. Whereupon they are open to a conceptual change. Yesteryear's formulations can be thrown out. New formulations can be brought in. Of course, the modernists will say, I have preserved the essence of the meaning of the doctrine. That's what they all say. Skillebeck says, there never was an empty tomb. The resurrection of Christ is not, in any ordinary sense, an historical event. The resurrection is really Christ's passage into an invisible mode of being in which he sort of hangs around as grace and is able to invade souls. But the actual resurrection from the dead, as it has been traditionally taught, together with the empty tomb, he denies. Does he admit that he denies the resurrection? Of course not. He says, I've reformulated the doctrine for our time. I have remained faithful to the essential core. Jesus lives on. Uh-huh. Yeah. All I have done, he will say, is reinterpret. If there's a modernist gap, there's room for reinterpretation.